The video will cover section 10.6, which is the second to last section of chapter 10, and the title is Counting Principles, Permutations, and Combinations. First, we're going to go over the fundamental counting principle, which talks about the number of ways in which a series of things can occur. And so a very good example of this will be your wardrobe. And for example, if you ladies have ever read or seen online that you only need like a few items and you can just mix and match and create like 50, 100 outfits. Mm-hmm. Right? Guys, you're into those magazines too? Like GQ? They do have stuff like I could see it. and it's very smart because you can buy quality items and just mix and match them and they last you longer. So anyways, right here we have this guy who we know is not Bastion. Only has two pairs of jeans or pants. And so he has a total of three shirts, 1, 2, and 3. And he has a total of two different pairs of shoes, a black pair and a red pair. So if you count all the items, and this is like a tree diagram, if you count all the outfits that he gets at the end, all the ones listed here, how many outfits can he have?
12. 6.
So I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Yeah, considering different shoes. So he has 12. Now, when you're a girl and you have like a skirt and some pants and then some jeans and things like that, I mean, you can create like really different items. Outfits. So here we have a total of 12 outfits. Now, how can we do this mathematically without using the tree diagram? So that is what the counting principle is. And so I'm going to list the pants. He had two. And then shirts. He had three, the tan, yellow, and blue. And then he had shoes, and he had two pairs of shoes. Now here we're not considering if he likes to mix and match his shoes, right? Some people like to do that. A lot of soccer players do that. Have you guys noticed?
Yeah.
In football, like, you used to, like,
yeah. That's true.
We, like, wear different pairs, like, each.
Yeah, like, they will wear a pink and a blue or green. Oh, yeah, pink was totally in at the last World Cup.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so 2 times 3 times 2, you multiply, and then you get 12. Which is the same number that we counted here, right? 12 different outfits. All right, so now we're going to do a similar problem using the counting principle. And this is our options in planning a schedule. And they're like a little out there. These are like in a little unrealistic because it's saying here that you don't have any scheduling conflicts, and we know that's never true, right? All right, so let's see. We have math, English, and humanities. So based on that, so we're going to have three courses, math, English, uppercase, and humanities. So based on that, we see that there's some highly recommended professors, and they are offering 8 sections in math, 5 in English, and 4 in humanities. So those are the numbers that we will use, 8 for math, 5 for English, 4 for humanity. And so if we multiply that, we'll get...
Quick question. 5,
yes.
5 teachers or 5 different
schools? 160.
5, let's see. They're calling them sections.
What was it like different, like there's 5 classes?
Yes. Uh-huh. That's why I said that example is a little bit unrealistic, right? Especially at this campus.
Yeah.
Okay. Perhaps at UTEP you might have that. So many options for the lower level classes, but not for the senior level classes. Sometimes you only have one option for a senior level class. Yeah. So let's move on to the next one. Any questions so far? No? Okay. All right, so now here, a multiple choice test. You're taking a multiple choice test that has 10 questions. Each of the questions has 4 answer choices. So we're talking about a test that it will have like blah, 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 and then you'll have like A, B, C, and D, okay? We're not talking about matching, it's just each question has 4 choices. So what we're gonna do is consider the first question, second, and so on, all the way to the 10th question. And then we're going to consider the 4 choices for each question. And to answer the problem, it says, if you select one of these 4 choices for each question and leave nothing blank, in how many ways can you answer the question? So we have 4 options for each. So if you have your calculator ready, use your help. And there's a better way than just entering 4 times 4 times 4. Thank you. So 4 to the power 10. So if you could, one of you could please enter that on your calculator. Oh. It's a pretty big number, though. Actually, I need more room. Anyone?
1048 5 7 6
Wait, hold on. So 1 million 48 possible ways. Now let's pretend that you didn't study. And you just come to class to take your test because you think you're so smart and you can just wing it, right? And you're so lucky. And let's say by guessing. And how many, what's the probability that by guessing, you will get 100?
Well,
10%. Let's see. So, considering that out of your 4 choices, that you chose the correct one for all, what? There's only one way that that can happen. There's only one answer key that contains 100, right? 100 points. So, 1 out of 1,048,576. Can you do that for me? Someone with a calculator? Yes. So don't do that. Don't think that by guessing you're going to get 100.
It could be worse. I'm never going to 100 by guessing, but I'm going to get 8.
Hey, maybe you should go to Vegas when you're 21. Okay. So now you guys do the checkpoint 2 on your own, and then we will check. Please don't wait for me to write the answer on the board. Give it a try. Okay, so 729. So we had 6 questions, and we had 3 answer choices. So 3 to the power 6. Sometimes it's very common that you might say, and I used to do this in college when I took a probability class, I remember. I got that question wrong. I will never forget. But anyway, it's very common when people do this. So make sure that you don't. Okay, think about the problem. Think about, is it three questions with six choices each, or, you know. And that's why I like to do the little lines, since I got that question wrong. Okay.
No.
It doesn't. If it was like 3 times 6 or 6 times 3, yes, multiplication is negative. But that one will be there. Okay, so let's go to the next one. And now we're going to talk about telephone numbers in the United States.
Oh.
Which is actually becoming an issue.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why so many people?
You'll see. Okay, so telephone numbers in the United States, they begin with a 3-digit area code, followed by a 7-digit local telephone number. Now, we have to consider that the area code and the telephone number cannot begin with a 0 or a 1.
Why not the phone?
That's a great question. Yes.
Wait, the area? No, never mind.
Okay, so let's see why not. With a 0, I really don't know if this is still is true. But back in the day, if you used to dial 0, it will connect you to the phone operator.
Yeah.
A person who worked for the phone company, like for landlines.
How long ago was this?
Huh?
How long ago was this?
Hey, not that long. I don't remember.
That's
Let me see. Like about 25 years ago? Okay, so that's why we cannot use 0. Okay, now let's talk about 1. 1 is the code of the country. So the US is 1.
We're number 1.
Yeah.
I don't know who chose those codes, but we got number 1.
The US?
What is the code for Mexico?
104.
6.
3.
That's the one from 4 Juarez.
It's
2.
No, that's
1.
Okay. What do you dial after 011? Yes, 52. It's 52. So, I mean, every country has a different code. So that's why we have to take out 0 and 1. All right? So how many digits do we have? You should know this from Pi Day. How many digits do you have if you consider 0, 1, 2? Oh. 0, 1, 2, all the way to 9. How many digits?
10.
10, right? So for every single number, we're going to have 10 options, except for the first one of the area code and the first one of the local telephone number. So how many options are we going to have for those if we have to take 0 and 1 out?
8.
Very good. So now to solve that problem, of course, you can multiply all of those, or you could rewrite it as 8 to the power what?
Square.
Mm-hmm, 2 square, very good. And 10 to what power?
That would be 8.
Okay, very good. So someone with a calculator handy, please?
64 times 10 million. 640 million.
Are you guessing?
No, I mean, it's 64 times 10 million.
It's 100 million.
But if you think about it, there are already 6 billion people on the planet.
Yeah, but there's only 385 million people in the US.
Okay, so how many millions do we have?
Six. Oh,
6.4.
Now, is that right,
sir? I'm asking. We got 6 billion? I don't know if I do it right.
I'm asking
for
6 billion.
But I thought it was 640.
$6 billion.
Can someone verify with a calculator?
Yeah, that's 640 billion.
Just check this in, just to make sure.
Yeah, that's the right answer.
Okay, so we're talking about 6 billion, and then you guys are mentioning what's the population of the U.S.?
Like 385
million. 385
million.
Okay, so if you consider numbers such as your phone number, I mean your home. Your work, your personal cell phone. Some people have company cell phones. Yes. So how many phone numbers could a person potentially have? Up to 4, maybe more, maybe less. Maybe if we take all the little kids out.
Yeah, plus like not everybody does.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But most people do. However, it is predicted that by the year 2020, and this is actually on your textbook, that we're going to run out of phone numbers.
By 2020?
Yes. So what can we do to fix that problem?
No more company sales,
yeah,
and
maybe
no
should
more
do
work phones, and no more home.
How about we just make a bigger phone number?
What do you say?
Just make a bigger phone.
Exactly. You add another number.
Why don't you just take up the company cell phones and like drop them?
Well, I think that would be an issue to certain business owners.
Be against the law, exactly.
Now, another thing we were discussing is that sometimes cell numbers are not recycled, but sometimes they are.
Yeah.
I don't know. Okay, so let's talk about license plates. So, how about you guys do that?
Wait, Ms. Arthur, different combinations for different states, like this and stuff like
that. Yeah, we'll talk about that in a minute.
And some have more numbers in your
states than others. Yeah, some more numbers in this.
Wow.
Okay, so if you dial 911, another state will still put you to that, like, to the state.
So it's 2, and then 5.6, 3, 9.
Okay, so we got this answer. We're going to check if it is correct. So if we consider at this particular state, they only have a total of 5 spaces. The first 2 are reserved for letters, so that would be 26. And then for digits, we're not restricting any numbers, so we have 10 options, considering from 0 to 9. So that will be 26 to the power 2 times 10 to the power 3. And can someone please give me an answer?
676 with 3 zeros.
676. Okay, 676,000. How many spaces do we have in Texas?
6.
For our license plates. 6, right? And so, for example, we can have, I have seen plates that will have maybe some letters and then numbers, or there are some where they are interchanged, where they have the numbers first and then the letters.
What about custom?
Yeah, I was going to say.
And then, yes, yeah. And then if we include those, so we will have a lot more options, right? So I think we're okay. We're not about to run out of license plates. So this takes me to one thing that when you consider, let's say I had something like,
can they be like mixed?
I think I've seen them, yeah.
Wait, but aren't they recyclable?
I'm not sure what is the procedure on that. Like, it might take years to recycle one. Okay, so if we were to have A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, will those two license plates be the same?
No.
No, right? Because the order matters. So the order is going to make it different. All right, so let's go to the next slide. Now we're going to talk about permutations. Okay. I just need to make a little bit of space here. Okay, so I'm going to copy the definition. Permutation is an order arrangement of items that occurs when two things happen. One, no item is used more than once. And second, the order of the arrangement makes no difference. Now, the notation that we could use for a permutation will be like this, NPR. And what it means is the number of permutations . Think about the word permutation as possibilities. So the number of permutations of n things, like out of n options taken, are items at a time.
You spelled arrangement wrong.
Huh?
You spelled arrangement wrong.
This is not English class.
Thank you. Thank you, Miguel. Since I'm a highly educated individual, I'm going to correct my writing.
I don't like this
Why?
He talks too much.
Who?
Oh, I agree. Yes.
So you are the prophet.
I agree.
Okay. So let's talk about this a little more. Yes.
Does the P stand for permutation?
Yes. So let me explain something to you. Raise your hand if you have ever play baseball or softball? Oh, okay, good. We have a lot of baseball players, softball players. Great. So, how many baseball players are in a team?
On the field, or?
Well, in general, like a team has to have how many? At least?
At least 10.
8?
On the field, 9, like at least.
On the field, 9, that's true.
And then, in general, like 14.
I'm going to use an example of 13 players. I don't know, I could be wrong, but we're going to use 13. So, when you were a baseball player, you know, maybe you were good, maybe you were not. Maybe you were in the middle. Maybe you were the best. Maybe you were the worst. So when you were going to bat, the order in which you went to bat, it really mattered, right?
Yeah.
Do you remember that? So you want to start strong, and you want to finish strong. Because you could have, well, you could have, I mean, I'm no baseball player, but I know this. You could have, I know there's a term for it, but you could have people at every base.
Oh,
and if you get a home run, you get
a cleanup. Okay.
So that's why you want to finish strong. So let's see. We have, at once, you could have 9 people who will go. And 9. So for your first player who will go to hit the ball, you have 13 options. Now that kid is already out on the field, right? Hopefully they didn't get, not out in a bad way, like he's already on the field. Now how many options do we have for the second batter?
12.
And then 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. And 5. So that could be a way to get the permutations, like how many options you will have. I don't have the answer here for me. If you guys could do that, one of you with a calculator.
Just call the middle one.
But that will be in how many different ways the coach can actually make his roster. So they do actually have a little bit of a tough job when they decide that, because there's so many possibilities. Now, without doing that, we could use a formula. And so that formula will be here. And that one is using factorial. We used that before, so I think you'll remember how. Okay, so we have you and your 19 of your friends have decided to form an internet marketing consulting firm. The group needs to choose 3 officers, a CEO, an operating manager, and a treasurer. Do you guys think the order matters there? Actually, it does, because a CEO is the chief executive officer. He's the ultimate decision maker. The operating manager has to answer to the CEO, and the treasurer has to answer to the CEO as well. I don't know what relationship will exist between those two. What were you saying, Sean?
So does it matter for this problem?
Yes.
Is it just going to take out place?
No, it doesn't matter for this problem. And even though your friends, you cannot count on your friends forever. Have you guys seen, what is that movie? Is it just Facebook? Is that the name of the movie? Facebook?
Oh,
yeah.
The
you know, so they were friends, and it ended up in a lot of drama. And it was a true story. So anyways, so we have 19 friends. So if we were to do it like the baseball problem, it will be 19, and then you have 18, and then you have 17.
But do you count yourself as a student?
You're right. You are right. It should be 20. Thank you, Biryani. 20 times 19 times 18. Very good. Now, using the formula, we're going to say out of 20, we're gonna select 3. So that will be like 20 is representing the n, the total of items. So that will be 20 factorial over n minus r factorial. So it will be 20 minus 3 factorial. Now here we will have 20 factorial. And on the bottom, what is 20 minus 3? 17 factorial. Now, if you remember, we have a way to solve this with a shortcut, right?
Yes. 20 minus 18 is
17 factorial. Oh, and what did we get? The same thing as if we had done it without the formula. Right? So, can you guys please slide that for me? Is it too cold in here?
We're about to see...
What is the what? So, 20 times 19 times 18...
6,800.
Okay, I can't hear. 6,000? Thank you. And that is because the order matters. All right, now you guys do the checkpoint 4. And let me ask you before, does it matter who's the president, vice president, secretary, and the treasurer? Yes, it does. So we have here 4 positions, and we have 7 members, so 7 times 6 times 5 times 4, and if you use the formula, it should be something like out of 7, you are going to take 4, order matters, so 7 factorial over 7 minus 4 factorial, 7 factorial over 3 factorial, so that will be 7 times 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 factorial over 3 factorial, so that will make up a 1, and that is the answer. So what is the answer, guys?
840.
Wait, in the definition you put the order of the arrangement makes no difference, but then right now you're saying order matters?
Yeah. It doesn't make a difference. It doesn't make a difference. Like, it doesn't matter.
Because if you kind of, if you put, like, let's say number 7 as the president, you can't also put him for vice president, the secretary.
Let me.
You put it in capital letters, don't you see?
And then I'm saying the opposite. Okay, let me, during the break, I will look at that. And then I will answer your question.
Can I start a question?
Yes.
Why did you, for checkpoint 4, why did you also put 3? That was 4 positions.
Oh, here?
Yeah.
Oh, because 7 minus 4?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so why don't you guys go take a break, and then I'll check that definition. Maybe I copied the wrong. So I made a mistake with the definition because this part here, it only applies to combination. So what we need to do is just erase that because I know you were using a pencil, right?
No.
So too bad. So then we're going to say that the order actually matters.
So we can just erase that word, doesn't make a difference.
No, uh-huh. Yeah, because a huge difference. order does matter. So, what I was telling you, the way we work the problems out was correct. The order matters. I mean, I did take senior level probability and statistics courses, and also during my master's, so yes, I know. But I made a mistake, and I'm very happy that Dima caught it. So I'm going to give you a highlighter. You could choose your color.
Is that a
highlighter? It is orange.
Okay.
Yeah.
It looks like nail polish.
Yeah, but it's a highlighter.
So just pull it out.
Yes. So thank you, Dima, because that tells me that you actually paid attention to the definition and to what I was saying. So thank you for that. All right. Yay. Yes. Huh?
You just always start with the greatest burger.
For permutation?
Yeah.
Yes, because those are like all your possibilities. So it's out of all of those. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay, so next slide. So now, using the formula for permutation. So right here, you need to arrange 7 books along a small shelf. And how many different ways can you arrange them, assuming that the order of the books makes a difference to you? So maybe an OCD person. So the order matters. So we're going to use a permutation. Out of the 7, you have to order 7. So it will be 7 factorial over 7 minus 7 factorial. That's the n minus r part. And this will be 7 factorial over 0 factorial. And you should know that 0 factorial is equal to 1. And so 7 factorial, what would that be?
5,040.
5,000?
Yeah.
You sure?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Karina. All right, so we're going to skip checkpoint 5 because it's just the same. It's just with a 6. All right? Okay. So let's go to the next slide. Now, combination. That's where the order makes no difference. Okay. So we will have a combination when the items are selected from the same group. So that is 1. 2, it will be no item is used more than once. And 3, the order of the items makes no difference. So quickly, could I have someone to volunteer to read? Okay, thank you, Bastian. You will read the next one?
Yeah.
Well, let me read the instructions. So for each of the following problems, determine whether the problem is involving permutations or combinations. So remember, permutations, that's where the order matters. Right, so go ahead and read the first one.
6 students are running for student government president, vice president, and treasurer. The student with the greatest number of votes becomes the president, the second highest voter getter becomes the vice president, and the student who gets third largest number of votes will be treasurer. How many different outcomes are possible for these 3 positions?
Okay, so right now we're just determining if it's permutation or combination. What do you guys think?
Permutation.
Permutation, because you're talking about a first, second, and third, like if you were talking about a race. It matters in which order you get there. So we will say permutation. Now, if you were talking about just, actually, the next one is a very good example. Okay, who was going to read? Peru, thank you.
6 people are on the board of supervisors for your neighborhood park. A three-person committee is needed to study the possibility of expanding the park. How many different committees could be formed from the six people?
So right here, we're just talking about committee. We're not talking about who's the boss of who. So it doesn't matter. You just need three people. So what would that be?
Combination.
Is this class sponsored by Baskerville?
Maybe.
Brought to you by Baskerville.
Okay, we'll like to read the last one. Okay, Sean, thank you.
Baskin Robbins offers 31 different flavors of ice cream. One of its items is a bowl consisting of three scoops of ice cream, each a different flavor. How many such bowls are possible?
What would that be?
Combination.
Unless you're Miss Seven.
And you have to get the same scoop.
And you have to get a specific order.
No, I don't like...
Like, when I go to Menchie's, I have to get my coconut yogurt on the bottom.
Me too.
Really? And then the pistachio on top. Like, I cannot do the other way. It just doesn't work for me. My difference is that the pistachio is sweeter. So when I get to the bottom, I'm kind of like tired of the sweet taste, and the coconut is not as sweet. That's my reasoning.
Smart.
That's my excuse for
like drink food.
Yeah,
it's a spooky reason.
Okay. Let's talk about the notation for combinations, and so it looks like that. And what it means, NCR, C for combination, it means the number of combinations of N things taken R at a time. And we don't care about the order. So this is a great example. Imagine, well, you don't have to imagine, you can see it here. You have four letters, A, B, C, D. And if you have four and you're going to choose three, and how many ways can you do that? So that would just be 4 factorial over 4 minus 3 factorial. So that will be 4 factorial over 1 factorial. And so 4 factorial is what? Thank you. Divided by 1, so 24, right? Oh, sorry. This is permutation. I'm sorry. Yes, 24. And they're listed here. So you have 6 and 6 and 6 and 6. So 6 times 4 gives us 24. So I did the formula for permutation. Sorry about that. Now, if we consider combinations where the order makes no difference, there are only 4 combinations, and those 4 combinations are listed here. That's 1, 2, 3, and 4. You could have, remember we have 4 letters, A, B, C, D. So you could have A, B, C, A, B, D, A, C, D, B, C, D. Okay, that is combination. So it doesn't matter if you have the A first, or the B first, or the C first, that will be the same, because order does not matter. But if you talk about permutations where the order matters, ABC is not the same as ACB, or BAC, or BCA, or CAB, or CBA. Okay? So right here you can picture very good the difference between one and the other. Now, let's just arrive to the combination formula. So, using permutations, actually, I already did that part here, but let me just rewrite it. 4 factorial, 4 minus 3 factorial, and so that will give us 4 factorial over 1 factorial, which was 24. Now, combinations, we already know that we only have 4 combinations. So, if you had to make a little relationship between the 24 and the 4, and I'm talking about Does one go into the other?
Yes.
How many times?
6 times.
Okay, 6 times. So how many more permutations do we have than combinations? It will be 4 times 6. So we have 6 times as more, or as much, or as many. So if we, what that is telling me is that that number 6 right here is going to make the difference between the two formulas. So to summarize it, to get a combination, you will do the following. You will use 4 factorial, 4 minus 3 factorial, but then we still have to divide by what? By 6, so it's r factorial. Very good. Not 6, sorry. Three factorial, which will be 6. Okay, so in terms of n and r, the formula will be n factorial times n minus r factorial, and then r factorial, like Sean was saying. So that is the difference. That formula you could see it here. Just to remind you, you could see both together, that is combination, and the one for permutation, it doesn't have that extra r factorial on the bottom. So since we are dividing by another number here, that's why we get less options when we talk about a combination. Okay, so the last slide. Oh, perfect. So we have here a 3-person committee is needed to study ways of improving public transportation. How many committees could be formed from the 8 people on the board of supervisors? So committees, that doesn't really matter. Although sometimes you have like a committee president, but let's not worry about that. So we have 8 people combination with, we're gonna choose 3. So that will be 8 factorial over 8 minus 3 factorial times 3 factorial. So that will be 8 factorial times 5 factorial times 3 factorial. Do you guys remember doing things like that in section 10.1 a little bit with factorials? If you don't, maybe you should do your homework. So this will be, I'm going to use 8 times 7 times 6 and then 5 factorial, because I am trying to cancel it with the one on the bottom. And so 5 factorial goes with 5 factorial. And what is 3 factorial, guys? It's like 3 times 2 is 6. So that could be canceled with a 6. And so the answer will just be 8 times 7, which is 56. Okay. You have a group of 10 positions. And how many ways can you select 4 to go to a conference? So again, we're going to have, out of 10, we're going to choose 4. So that will be 10 factorial over 10 minus 4 factorial times 4 factorial. So 10 factorial over 6 factorial times 4 factorial. This will be 10 times 9 times 8 times 7 times 6 factorial. 6 factorial on the bottom, 4 factorial. 6 with 6. And does anyone have that answer?
210.
210.
Okay, 210. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about a 52-card deck who belongs to a group of people playing poker. So how many cards? I don't know. How many cards do you get when you play poker? 5. And so, do we know why that costs 52?
Because
so we have hearts, we have diamonds.
Spades and.
It's called each deck, right?
Yeah.
I'm not very good
at
that. Okay. 13. There are 13 in each. Uh huh. So 13 times 4 will give us the total of 52. So if we have 52, and the order obviously does not matter, right? Because you are the one who orders your own cards together. So 52, and you're going to choose or be dealt 5. So that will be 52 factorial over 52 minus 5 factorial times 5 factorial. So just to reduce it quickly, we have 52 factorial. And then what is 52 minus 5?
47.
Okay, 5 factorial. And so that will be, you could actually enter it on the calculator like that. Do you know where the factorial symbol is?
Yes.
Oh.
We're not sure, I don't know. Can you tell
me? I think it's by the comma?
By the question mark?
The question mark. And then you will see the exclamation. Or you could always go to menu and then probability and then you'll see it there. It's a pretty big number. Starts with a 2. I know that. Okay, can you tell me digit by digit, please?
2, 5, 9, 8, 9, 6, 0.
Okay. So what does that mean? That means that there are 2,598,960 possible hands of poker that you could get. So what is the biggest hand that you can get? I mean, the one that beats and everything. A type of flush. It's a royal flush, like this one. So that means that, of course, to be a flush, they have to be of. Is that the same suit, or they have to be consecutive?
Well, for a royal
same suit.
Flush,
it's a same suit.
Both.
Yeah.
I think the straight is the one that has to be consecutive. Oh my God, I need to polish my skills.
And you want to go to Vegas again?
I know. So, anyways, just quickly, this one wins because there's only 4 different ways that you can get that. And so the probability to get that, in my other class they were telling me, isn't it like 4 of a kind, more specifically 4 aces? Well, no, because the probability of getting this one is a lot smaller than getting 4 aces. And that's why that one will be anything. If we had more time, I will show you the probabilities for each hand, but maybe we could do that next class. So that's it. You guys are good to go.